is about speaking out. So it's not new, it's not something that Mike hasn't talked about, so it isn't something that we've been doing for a little while now, but I want to encourage everyone, exhort everybody to be in that battle, in the army, as we talked about, as we sang about before. It's so important that we realise we are in a battle. You know, when we sort of signed up to be a Christian, maybe the preacher said, you will have a wonderful life, you'll be in Jesus, and you will have everything will come right, and etc., etc. But they didn't tell us that we're going to be in a really horrendous battle. And he says that on this earth we will suffer tribulation. At least I don't know the exact words of the scripture, but it says, but I've overcome the world.
Amen.
Now, we sang about it earlier, you know, how does he say that? He may say it in a kind of a, you know, I've overcome the world. Think about it, you know. Or he may say, hey, I've overcome the world. Don't worry about it. It's all right, you know. So I'm going to speak from the story of Abigail. Because she spoke out. Not everyone might be familiar with this story. But the story of Abigail teaches us that there is a way to speak out, and we have to stand firm in what is right, in honour and obedience, and in the face of common thinking, customs and the ways of the world and the pressure to go the world's way. Abigail acted in a surprising way. She risked everything for God, everything. And we have to do this too. Not thinking of the consequences, despite her status as a wealthy woman. The story starts, if you'd like to turn to 1 Samuel 25. This isn't word for word that's in the scriptures, but I'm going to sort of read out the story. The story starts with an extremely rich man. He had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and probably much else as well. His name was Nabal, which means fool. And if you look up the meaning of his name, there's also root words that mean unbeliever and stingy. His wife was called Abigail, which means my father rejoices exuberantly. How lovely is that? She must have been a delight to her father. How incredible. When she was born. But Nabal, the man she had married, in whatever circumstances, we don't know. Did he buy her? His riches being to his family? To her family, sorry, something that would be something you would seek after. You know, marry a man like this because he'll give you everything all of your life. So Nabal was hard and bad in his doings. Now David was on the run from Saul and sent 10 young men to Carmel to greet Nabal and tell him that they had protected his shepherds while they were shearing. And they had not hurt them or stolen from them. Because it would have been easy to do that. You know, David and his men could have been pretty desperate, couldn't they? They could have had a lot of need. They were on the run, of course, and obviously that would be an opportunity. But they had not done that. So they came to him, to Nabal, on a feast day, because there was lots of celebration with the shearing. And they asked for some food from him. They asked that he would bless them in exchange, if you like, for the protection that he gave, that they had given to his shepherds. And Nabal answered, who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? There are many that break away from his master. This was in reference to Saul's pursuit of him, clearly. Why should I give my bread and meat meant for my shearers to strangers? So it was clearly a put down, a complete put down of David, and not realizing being an unspiritual man, he wouldn't see where David was, who David was, and about his anointing. But Abigail did. The men returned to David and told him what had happened. David was angry. Anger rose up in him. And he ordered 400 men to put on their swords. In the meantime, one of Nabal's men told Abigail how her husband had treated David's men, despite how they had protected the shearers. He warned her that they were coming to slaughter them, to slaughter Nabal and the whole household. And that Nabal wouldn't listen because he was such a wicked man. Immediately, she got up. She realized what she had to do. She took wine, bread, meat, and laid it on donkeys. But she didn't tell Nabal. She then set out to where David was camped. As David set out, he got more angry that he'd been paid evil for good. It was in the customs of those days, you could pay evil for evil and good with good. So David was insulted, completely insulted. And he also had murderous thoughts because he wanted to slaughter his home, his house, his whole household, Nabal's. David met Abigail on the road. She dismounted. And the first thing that she did was humble herself before him. Now she could have sat on her donkey and saw herself as an equal to David, but no, she humbled herself. She took the low position. She told him that Nabal, her husband, was a wicked man and apologized to David for Nabal's behavior. She told him that the Lord had sent her. Now this is important, that the Lord had sent her. She knew from the Lord that she was meant to do something here, to put things right. She told him that the Lord had sent her to not allow David to have blood on his hands and suffer the consequence. And she asked David for his forgiveness and for him to take the blessings of the food. And everything hinged on this moment, you know. What would David do? Would he still have murderous thoughts? Could he kill her? Would he just push her out of the way and carry on with his men and slaughter the whole household of Nabal? But she prophesied that he was a sure house. This is what the Lord's saying. He was a sure house who fights God's battles. And he had no evil in his life. That was to that point anyway. We know that David, you know, did go wrong in the future, of course. But he would be a glorious man in battle. And his enemies would be fired out as if from a sling. They were thrust out from him as through a sling. And above all, that he would become the ruler of Israel, the king of Israel. Excuse me. And she asked him then, would you remember me when you come into the dealings that God will deal with you with? He thanked her. And he thanked her particularly that he'd not avenged himself with blood. Because that's a terrible thing. He would have had to suffer the consequences. and it would have been really hard for him to go from there as king. He accepted the gifts. Nabal was feasting and was drunk when Abigail returned. So in the morning, she told him all this had happened. And he died instantly of a heart attack. God repaid evil with evil. The scriptures say he became like a stone. So obviously he was taken away. And 10 days later he actually died. So as I said, the Lord had turned Nabal's wickedness upon him. David thanked the Lord deep in his heart for speaking through Abigail, because she had saved him from this terrible thing, stopped him from doing evil. David afterwards sent for Abigail, and she became his wife. How wonderful. And when we look at the characters here, if we look at who is here, Abigail, is she the bride? Like the bride of Yeshua? The church? Rescued from sin? Nabal? Being married to that man was like being married to sin. To be the bride of the king, David, Yeshua. Abigail had spoken out and acted against the will of her husband, which would surely be condemned in all cultures. And this, as we are talking about it in this atmosphere we have of standing out and, you know, petitions and letters we have and so on. She showed the way to standing strong in a situation when everything seems most, you know, forceful from the world. The world will say this, but God has a different plan. He will say something different. So this is standing firm and standing strong for what is right. And God has shown her how to stand strong in this situation with regard to David and even her husband. And sometimes we have to speak out for God's way. No matter whatever the circumstances could be, if we know God is saying this, we have to do it. We have to do the deed, do the right thing, even if it divides. And sometimes that's hard to understand, that's hard to get. But it divides. It can divide. Yeshua said in Luke 12, verse 51, if you want to turn to it, he said, "Do you suppose that I am come to give peace on earth? No, he said, but rather division." It's hard to understand that scripture in some ways from what we've been taught in the past. Rather division. Father against son, mother against daughter, etc., etc. You'll know the scripture. So God sometimes allows and creates division for his own purpose. But Abigail, apart from doing what she knew was right in God, she was also a peacemaker. If you turn to Matthew 5, verse 9, Yeshua said on the Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Yeshua is the ultimate peacemaker. Yes? Amen. Colossians 1, verse 20. for it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him and through him, to reconcile all things to himself, all things. Having made peace through the blood of the cross. Just think about that for a moment. We turn to 2 Corinthians 5, verse 18. So God reconciled us to himself. Through who? Yeshua. And he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So we've got two things going on here. But here, in this case, those who bring reconciliation are doing Yeshua's work. Those who give of themselves, that others may know God, are therefore blessed. We ought to lead people to the Lord, so no matter what we do, the Great Commission says that we must lead people to the Lord, doesn't it? Go out into all the world and preach the gospel. Amen. The ultimate broken relationship is between God and man. The world doesn't see that. But Romans 5, verse 1, if you want to turn to that. We now have peace with God through Yeshua. God willing, we can right the wrongs of the past. Banger on D, on the orders of Rome. I don't know the year. What year was it, Mike?
722.
1,200 Christians were slaughtered for standing for Torah, by worshipping on the seventh day. Saturday, of course, the true Sabbath. That's why we're here today. And for celebrating God's feasts. And by visiting that area and praying in advance to reclaim the very ground that this atrocity was carried out on, to cleanse it and to break off curses, to reclaim and to reopen the ancient paths.
Amen.
That's our aim. That was our aim. Last time, I didn't, it was the first one. And we have another one coming up soon, so I would exhort you to come to the next one. And this is before Passover. When we have the Passover, we're going to celebrate Passover there, of course, and we're going to right the wrongs of the past. So you can see that this is clearly what is happening, what God is stirring us up for, and why we're doing the things we're doing. Abigail and other prophets brought a strong message of truth, not compromise. And that's what we tend to do today in today's society. We compromise so much in every area, in many areas. Sometimes people may lose family, including wives and husbands, to obey God. This is a fact. We have to be careful, very careful, because we can be sidetracked. You know, we can be convinced, or they'll try and convince us that this is the way. Come with us, join us, so on. So people may lose family. You can't take the unsaved by the hand. It's just interesting, we all held hands before. And lead them to heaven, not directly. We can lead them by the hand or otherwise to salvation but by telling them the truth. That's the important thing. We mustn't pussyfoot around, you know. It has to be the truth. We mustn't pull punches. You know, with family, friends, work colleagues, whoever you have time with, interaction with in any way, the message of love to them is truth and not compromise. Family, yes, can do the work of the enemy sometimes and try to draw us away from the truth. I remember when I first became a Christian, my mom said to me, "Oh, you don't want to make your, you know, let all this Christianity rule your life." And I said, "Mom, it's my life. This is my life." Amen. And you notice in the world, you know, I used to smoke years ago, and, you know, as soon as I wanted to give up, you get people clamoring to give you cigarettes. This is what the world does, isn't it? This is what people do. They try to get you to, again, join me. Come with us, do it our way. But the Bible says, do not be conformed to this world. Amen. A wise man learns more from his enemies than a fool from his friends. Has anyone heard of that? Is it a proverb? No. It's not a proverb. It's a prose written by a Spanish, I think he's a philanthropist, they call him. Anyway. Matthew 16, verses 23 and 24, if you want to turn to that. Jesus, Yeshua, turned and said to Peter, you all know this, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Against the world, isn't it? This is Belial. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me."
Amen.
I'm sorry to bring this up, son, because I know some still do it. Okay, are we still doing Christmas and Easter? Because of pressure from family and friends. Use a conversation like, "I will keep doing it because it will make my husband or it'll make my wife happy, and you know, it might bring them to the Lord." Now that might be the case, I'm not knocking that. But how will they thank you for not telling the truth about the truth when it's too late? We must not allow ourselves to be talked out of this stand by feeling sorry for them. You have to be cruel to be kind. We must hate what God hates and love what God loves. The churches are now carrying out homosexual marriage. This is an abomination. This is clearly an abomination to God. Excuse me. Yes, we know we are meant to love the sinner, but not the sin. We have to tell the truth here, don't we? The Roman Church has changed a commandment, and you'll all know which one it is. They've allowed us to idolatry. All these churches have fallen into sin and are under judgment. Can we tell them? Are we ready to tell them? Are we prepared to tell them? Can we tell them about Torah? Will they listen? Possibly not. I know Mike's done this for years. Talked to many pastors locally, correcting them about the false teachings, false teaching on grace. This has now become a license to sin. Because I know that many people, I know some of the Christians that we know outside of here, This is one of the first things they say. The law, the law, the law. They don't understand Torah. It gives us boundaries, parameters. They don't know what grace really means. Would you turn to 2 Corinthians, chapter 6, verse 14 to 18. I'll read it out. Sorry? Yeah, 2 Corinthians 6, 14 to 18. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what concord has Yeshua, Christ, with Belial? Or what part has he that believes with an infidel? And what agreement has the temple of God to do with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be you separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father to you. And you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Amen.
Amen.
Would you turn to Psalm 1? Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, the Torah. And in his Torah does he meditate day and night. Because I think once we get this revelation, it doesn't leave your heart, does it? It doesn't let go of you. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. We want to bear fruit, don't we? The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgments, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. And it shows me that the chaff being blown away shows the sort of instability of people in the world and what they say to you. Bless them, of course. We want to win them for Yeshua. We want them to see salvation. But they won't believe. They won't see. Torah gives us parameters for living. For example, children are happiest when they have boundaries.
Yes.
Discipline is lacking in schools and in areas where there's social deprivation, poverty. This leads to dysfunction. It's all around us. We see this in this area, and that's why we're praying for this area. We're interceding for this area. We're hoping to make a difference and reach out to them and hopefully win them again for Yeshua. There's now in some schools, and I've been in them because I not so much nowadays, but I just do a lot of work in schools. And they even now have special rooms for teaching normal living, where there's furniture, there's irons, there's cookers, there's this and that. And they teach them how a normal home will run. I couldn't believe it when I saw it, but that's what's happening. These deprived areas are really suffering. So we need to intercede for our schools. and the deprived areas, we want to make a difference, as I said. We recently had a petition about bringing back the Ten Commandments in our schools. It didn't get a major response, but it did speak to some, and we did get some feedback about it. And I'm sure that many people in their heart of hearts would want that back, because we all remember when we were younger, the hymns we used to sing, you know, in the assemblies, and the scriptures that were read, and the RE classes, but RE now is about all the other religions, you know. Sadly, they are not of God. And so I think many people would like to see a return to the old ways, the old values, the old paths,
you know,
the ancient doors as we talked and sang about. Jeremiah 6:16, if you'd like to turn to that one. Says, stand at the crossroads, look and ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls. Wow. He saw this, he foresaw this, didn't he? God showed him. We're now about to give, apparently, sex education to 4-year-olds.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they say, that's not harmful. I heard someone on Sky News the other night say, this is just, it's only a mild introduction to relationships.
Yeah.
Can you believe that? That's the thin end of the wedge, surely. You know, what do they teach in the next year, 5-year-olds and 6-year-olds and so on? How bad will this be? How bad will this go? We need to tell the parents, you know, when we're at school gates. And lots of us grandparents are at the school gates. And we should be telling, not just the teachers, we should be telling the parents as well. And maybe stir them up a little bit and say, you shouldn't be accepting this for your children. They're even going to bring in compulsory sex education lessons that we cannot get out of. How bad is that? The occult is acceptable in most schools. And again, I see it in schools I go into, there's lots of books about the occult, including Harry Potter, but there's a lot more worse than that. It's not just Harry Potter, bad as it is. And it's also considered harmless fun. I'm afraid I have a brother that is almost obsessed with Harry Potter. I wish he wouldn't get involved in this. But he does. They have all the books, they have all the videos, and they even name one of their pets after one of the characters and think, oh my goodness. How much, you know, people entrenched in all these things and could suffer for it. I don't know, I wouldn't want to speak anything over my brother, but he had a heart attack 2 months ago. You know, bless him. You know, abortion, another subject. My wife is very involved in researching about abortion and sharing about it. Abortion is murder, and we have to be straight about it, absolutely straight. Whether the life is a fetus or outside of the womb, it's still a life, and it's being destroyed. These fetuses are being destroyed and being ripped apart. Terrible, is that? Exodus 20:13, you don't have to turn to it. Anybody know what that says? You shall not murder. And abortion is murder. As far as I'm concerned, that's murder. And Isaiah, would you like to turn to this? Isaiah 5, verse 20. Again, this is something that we're finding all the more. We refer to it quite a bit. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, darkness for light, bitter for sweet, etc., etc. We are in a battle. As we see these things going out before us, before our very eyes, we know clearly now we are in a battle. You know, even if we didn't see it before, when we still thought maybe Christianity was a thing of, you know, being blessed all the time, no, we're in a battle against powers and principalities. But we are to be wise as serpents and as gentle as doves, because we have to speak to these people, you know, that we come up against. We need to try to win them over, but there is hate. There's hate all around us. Look what happens now. Look what's going on with the Palestinian situation, ISIS, anti-Semitism, and so on. We are called to war. We are called to war. Ephesians 6, don't turn into it, it's okay. Paul tells us, I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly, as I ought to speak. Not that, oh, we might speak, it's we ought to speak, because that's what God wants us to do. We have to speak. We cannot sit still. We can't let it happen, as I ought to speak. We must hold a position. In all this attack, our values are being destroyed around us. We have to see it. We have to know it and do something about it. And how can we respond? Pray. There are many other things we can do. I'll come to that in a minute. We must intercede against, just a few in a list, among others, sexualization of children, abortion, anti-Semitism, Israel's right to exist. Mike said recently, all hell wants to silence you. And that really spoke to me. We know this, don't we? But sometimes we just need that little shake, and all hell wants to silence us. Doesn't that make us want to rise up and really, you know, give it to Satan? Really give it to him. Hard and strong. Bang, you know? We must speak out. Now, Abigail took a risk to speak out. And there is risk involved for all of us too. Because things could get pretty bad. Look at those street preachers. Look at them. They're only doing what they could do with no problem 20 years ago. But now, it's so changed. She spoke out for what she knew God was telling her. So we have to walk close with the Lord. We have to be close to the Lord and hear his voice and know what he's telling us. And then we can't walk into areas where we don't have any expertise or we don't have any covering, where we're at risk in any way. We have to be very, very careful. She went out with boldness without caring for what would seem right. She knew this would have had catastrophic consequences by not staying loyal to her husband had he have found out. But the anointing, this is important, the anointing was upon her as she made a stand for righteousness. And that's what we would be doing, making a stand for righteousness. In many situations, this is the case. We should always make a stand for righteousness. She didn't demand her rights as a wealthy and important woman. She took the lower place. And she humbled herself. And this is a huge lesson for us. If we have doubts about speaking out, remember that many of us in the Bible were not instantly ready, and many had flaws. Isaiah, he said, I have unclean lips. And coal came from the altar, the tongue to the altar. Moses was inadequate as a public speaker. Maybe he stuttered, maybe he just didn't have that confidence. And God used his brother. His brother. I said that's a bit scouts then. Brother. God used his brother. Jeremiah. What did Jeremiah say? I am but a youth. Or a child in some versions. God says that I chose you before I formed you in the womb. I set you apart before you were born. Maybe we're not called to be like them, because they were mighty men of God. As God moved in them, they gave their lives over to God. Maybe not like them, but we can write to our MPs, local councillors, or even the Prime Minister. Thank you, Margaret. It's a nice group. Or it may be just to sign a petition. You know, this is important. Some signed one yesterday about abortion-inducing drugs. Did some of you see that? Did you sign it? Compulsorily dispensed. They have got to put them out. The government, NHS, whatever, are telling them to dispense them. But we've got to make a stand about this, against this. We should speak out and pray, 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 and not let Satan try to take over. These are important times we're living in. Very important times. Sometimes God calls us, and even here, sometimes I think God might be wanting me to say that, and we say, oh no, it can't be wrong. It's wrong. And it's as if God's dialed the wrong number. Let me tell you, God doesn't dial the wrong number. He doesn't. Not at all. We say, I'm too shy. I don't know enough scripture. I haven't prayed much lately. I'm not in a good place at the moment. I'm sorry if you're going through something at the moment, and I do, everyone does. I'm not in a good place at the moment, and I'm working through my issues. Moving on. God says through the prophet, don't be afraid of their faces. Open your mouth and I will fill it. Typhus has put, my lovely wife, open your mouth. It sounds like an American. Open your mouth and I will fill it. 2 Corinthians 12, 8 to 10, if you want to turn to that. You all know this one. My grace, this is the grace that we understand. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. So when we are weak, we are strong. Amen. And as we put on the armour of God, because that's what God shows us and tells us to do, because we're in this battle, we put it on purposely. And it's in it's protection for every area that God wants us to pray into, speak out on, and be active for. Truth, righteousness, peace, salvation, Yeshua, the sword of the Spirit. Matthew 16, if you want to turn to that. You're well familiar with this one. Verse 24. Whoever is to be my disciple must deny themselves. That can be hard for people. But you have to deny yourself. And we do. Deny themselves and take up their cross to follow me. We're now living in a world of encroaching evil. And it's aided by political correctness. Such an evil, such an evil. And Yeshua says, do not be conformed to this world. We are to be in it, but not of it. We have to learn to operate in that way, to be in the world, but not of it. Stay clear of it. Our challenge is, do we obey God or man? And Abigail obeyed God. Amen. Just like to finish with a prayer. Father, thank you for your presence.